Hello, welcome to Conversations in Calvinism. I'm Dan Chapa, and I'm joined, as always, by my good friend, Turton Fan. How you been, Turton Fan?
Doing well. How about yourself?
Doing good, doing good. Happy to be with you, and happy to be discussing God's Word. And so today's episode is a review of John C. Poirier's book, The Invention of the Inspired Text. And just to share a little bit of the background, Trent Horn, and this was a while ago, posted a video and relied on some of the arguments from The Invention of the Inspired Text, and specifically referring to the word inspiration as God breathed, more in lines of kind of therapeutic, that it was healing or life-giving rather than God breathed. And we're going to look at some of those arguments today. We did a review on that back when Trent Horn initially put that video out. And the video there focused primarily on Trent Horn's arguments and how it applied to the Roman Catholic Church and how it applied to sola scriptura. And that was our point of emphasis in that video. However, there's been some subsequent events, and maybe you can pick it up from there to just give like the brief interactions that you've had related to that topic.
Yes. Sometime after that initial video, and I don't remember how long it was. I think it felt like it was quite a substantial gap of time, but apparently our video came to Poirier's attention, and he sent us a nice email that largely said that he didn't feel that our comments were a fair characterization of his book. And I, you know, as Dan just mentioned, I think part of that was because the focus of this was less on his book and more on Trent Horn's use of the material from his book. But the two things are to some extent connected. And ultimately, there were some aspects that Poirier didn't feel we handled to his satisfaction. So for now, that original video is offline, or I don't know the right term, but it's not easily able to be found online. I don't know if you can, if you know the exact URL, if you can go there, whatnot. But we may bring it back up after this episode, but we certainly wanted to bring this episode in order to do a more thorough discussion of that book, to express some of our concerns about that book, and to have less of a focus on the use and misuse of the book by Trent Horn. So I think ultimately some of the material that Poirier uses, Trent Horn would like, but other things he just couldn't get on board with because they're too far from Trent Horn's version of Roman Catholicism, which is fairly like standard Catholic answers, American Roman Catholic, conservative American Roman Catholic Catholicism. So he can't go down some of these paths. For an example of that, there's when Poirier discusses Timothy, the scripture, he treats it as though it's not by Paul, and Trent can't go down that path because Trent the council has said that it is by Paul, and he can't really backpedal that out and say it's not really by Paul. It's really written, I think, Poirier speculates that it's written in the, if I remember correctly from the book, the 110s or 120s, something like that. And that's just way too late. And he also thinks that's, if I recall correctly, that's also where he puts the Gospel of John. And Trent can't follow him down those roads. So the very late dating of it, he can't buy in. Now, the very late dating isn't necessarily the central point or the central thesis. So there's, you know, that's part of it. Now, keep in mind though, that also a very central aspect of Poirier's book, so that's this book, a central aspect of it is that he's writing this against inspiration, not against just this verse, not standing for inspiration, but generally the against inspiration as a model of understanding scripture. And his argument is that none of scripture teaches inspiration. It's not just that this verse doesn't teach it, but none of them do. And behind that seems to be an idea, not just that scripture doesn't teach it, but that it's not true. Now, I suppose maybe Trent could get on board and say, well, it is true, but you can't get it from Scripture. Therefore, you need the Roman Catholic Church or something like that. I guess. I don't know. But I think Trent would be wrong to go down that path for lots of reasons, including teachings of the Roman Catholic Church over the years, which have taught that Scripture teaches that it's inspired. So I don't think Trent can really go down, you know, arm in arm and walk through the argument that Poirier offers. But, you know, if he wants to do that, just he needs to sign up for that analysis. And we'll hopefully today we'll point out some of the flaws in that analysis. And then, you know, if Trent thinks he can, you know, revitalize them, so be it. But I'll try not to focus so much on Trent throughout this. It's going to be more focused on Poirier, unless something specific to Trent Horn comes up. I haven't seen him progress the argument beyond what he had presented in that debate in any meaningful way since that debate. That doesn't mean he hasn't talked about it at all, but just I haven't seen that, you know, some significant change in his view on that. So that said, we do have his, I should add, I generally don't publish private correspondence. And so I did get Poirier's permission to read from the letter that he provided. So this is quoted with permission from him and not, you know, not trying to undermine him or, you know, spread some secret information, you know, reveal secrets or something like that. But here is Theonistos, and I'm probably butchering the correct pronunciation. Some people pronounce Theopnustos because they're pronouncing that pi. I'm used to hearing it with a silent pi there, but Theonistos or Theopnustos. Or Theopneustos, I've heard as well. Anyway, the word here at the top, which is translated as God breathed or inspired, I've selected in this image this large jar that could be like some kind of ointment jar because of a reference that Poirier uses, some scrolls there, which could be inspired scripture or there could be something else, and some sandals, which is another thing that Poirier points out as being described in this terms, not with the exact word theonistos, but with a related word. So, first things first, this doctrine of inspiration doesn't hang solely on 2 Timothy 3:16. So 2 Timothy 3:16 says, in the King James Version, it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. This, you know, as I said, this is something that it teaches the inspiration of Scripture, and it's one of the places, it's the only place this particular word is used in the New Testament, but is it the only place that this concept is mentioned? And my answer to that is no. I don't know whether it's better now to mention the kind of exegetical argument that Poirier offers on this point, or whether it's better to wait on that.
Sure. I mean, I think it's good to give a bird's eye view first. So, okay. So for starters, just making sure that we're clear on this. So Poirier is really arguing, frankly, against the infallibility of Scripture. And part of his method, but only a part of it, is a redefinition of the inspiration of Scripture, that it's not God-breathed, but rather is life-giving, is the way he translates it. And so it goes back to the, you know, in the 70s and 80s, the whole battle for the Bible that was going on, and, you know, that sort of thing. I think it fits best into that genre. His position overall is that the Bible contains God's word, but it is not God's word. And the way he would phrase it is, okay, well, sure, the prophecies in Scripture are God's word. The gospel in Scripture is God's word. I don't know. Maybe he'd extend it further, like giving of the Ten Commandments or God's word. I don't know what he would say. But it's, in essence, there's pieces of God's word in the Bible, and that the Bible is enough to give life, but not every aspect of the Bible is divinely inspired or God breathed or God's word. I think is his overall picture. Yeah. So he in his, especially in his first chapter, he kind of has broader arguments that not just targeted at the use of inspiration in 2 Timothy 3:16, but every reference to God's word in scripture. And he's making arguments to take out the entire doctrine, in opposed to, frankly, the way not only that conservative Protestants take the Bible to be the inspired word of God, but frankly, probably Roman Catholics and Eastern Orthodox as well. So that's his overall perspective that he's bringing to the table.
I tend to echo that here, you know, mostly the same thing that you just said. I think the one place, if he were here to push back, and we did invite him to come, but if you're here to push back, he'd probably say, well, that he does think that scripture is God breathed, but for him, that means something else. Like, he would accept that the word, like the etymology of the word, is God breathed. But for him, that doesn't mean inspired. It means life-giving. And that it's life-giving in this sense, if I'm not mistaken, of somehow proclaiming the gospel. So that you get this kind of nugget of important stuff, which is the gospel, and the gospel gives life. And therefore, the rest of these other scriptures give life because they proclaim the gospel, not because they're true. He seems to be very insistent on trying to get away from characterizing the Bible as true, as though it's a kind of like a fundamentalistic obsession that the Bible has to be true. I don't know if he doesn't necessarily characterize in those terms, and I don't think he interacts in the book very much at all. I mean, I don't recall any interaction with Roman Catholic arguments or literature. I just don't recall. He tends to focus on the evangelicals as his target. And he interacts with Warfield quite a number of times in there. So, but in terms of like Roman Catholic arguments, I don't think he interacts at all.
Warfield and Charles Hodge, I think, on a Calvinist side, played a significant role in that. When some of those questions started stirring, back. Anyways, so yeah, so that's why I kind of put him into that genre when back in those debates, really, frankly. But carry on. You were on a roll, and I disrupted you.
Not at all. So if I'm not mistaken, when it comes to, and I hate being kind of speaking for him on these points. But I think when he sees this statement, instead of given by inspiration, he would say that it's all scripture is theopneustic, meaning that it's life-giving, it's vivifying, just being a fancier word for life-giving, that all scripture is life-giving. And for that, he would tie it, instead of tying it to the profitability for doctrine, etc., he would tie it instead to making you wise to salvation through faith, and then just say that the scripture's life-giving power is associated with getting salvation through faith. Which, if this were the only text, and assuming that his understanding of this phrase was fully viable, you could understand the kind of persuasive power of that kind of argument, and also the attractiveness to people who want to set aside the truth claims of scripture or reduce them down to this like core, this kind of tiny gospel core of maybe like the Apostles' Creed or something like this. And everything else around the Apostles' Creed is just up for grabs. It may or may not be true. And it may, like in this case, for 2 Timothy says it's from Paul to Timothy, but it's not really from Paul to Timothy, and kind of lots of other things flow from that, can result as from this. So that said, I don't think we're stuck, we being people who accept the whole New Testament for what it appears to be and for what it claims to be. We also can go to other places for the doctrine of inspiration. Amongst them is 2 Peter 1:21. And 2 Peter 1:21 is something he mentions and discusses a bit in his book. 2 Peter 1:21 says, "For prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." And I think in this verse is undervalued in Poirier's analysis. Notice in context, starting at verse 19, Peter tells us this is his, like, in his final word to people before he dies. He says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." So this idea of the Holy Ghost moving holy men, now this is an issue of, there's a translational issue that's pretty significant between the King James and some of the modern versions here. But this general concept, I don't know if you have a preferred translation of this verse, but the underlying point here, whether you use exactly they're carried along or moved by the Holy Spirit, and whether it says holy men or just men of God, but regardless of those kind of details, the underlying point is that there's this aspect of prophecy, and not just prophecy in general, but prophecy of the scripture. And there's this connection between the prophetic gift and scripture that's being highlighted in this passage. And the counterpoint from Poirier's side is, well, this applies to the prophetic portions of scripture, but not necessarily to all of scripture. And again, you know, if this were the only kind of place that we have a statement about this, maybe we would say, okay, fine, Peter's only talking about the prophetic portions of scripture. Except, of course, that then he treats Paul's writings as scripture later on. And also we have other verses to tell us things about the inspiration of scripture. Before I move on, other thoughts from you on this passage?
No, go ahead.
All right. So next up is a big one. This is John 10:35. And let me put it like this. So if you remember, Jesus says, "I and my Father are one." And then the Jews took up stones again to stone him. And Jesus said, "Many good works have I shown you from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me?" The Jews answered him, saying, "For a good work we don't stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God." Jesus answered them, "Is it not written in your law, 'I said, you are gods'? If he called them gods, unto whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be broken, say you of him, of whom the Father has sanctified and sent into the world, thou blasphemest, because I said, I am the Son of God." So Jesus, in this passage, in his own defense, is appealing to scripture, and he's specifically referring, he's saying that this passage that he's quoting, which is, if I recall correctly, from the Psalms, he says the scripture cannot be broken, and he calls this same scripture the word of God. So if the idea of, that there's an identity relationship, that all scripture is the word of God, this is at least implied by what Jesus is saying here. Also, this is the case that this passage, although you might say that David is considered a prophet, I think it was David. Psalm 82:6 is the psalm, and the author is Asaph. Sorry, not David. But whether you take Asaph as operating under David's umbrella or Asaph independently, you might say that this is a prophetic work because it points towards the Messiah in some way, although how exactly it points to the Messiah is not totally clear. It's a warning to unjust judges. In Psalm 82 is a warning to unjust judges. How long will you judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked is how verse 2 begins this diatribe. But he calls these judges gods, and he says it's those people are those to whom the word of God came and the scripture cannot be broken. So he's making an identification between the word of God and scripture, and he's doing that not only with reference to the prophets, the books of the prophets, but also with respect to the Psalms, which is in the third category of Jewish scriptures. There's the Torah, the prophets, and the other writings. The Psalms are in those other writings category, but even in that category, according to Jesus, the scripture can't be broken. So on top of which, the identification of scripture and the word of God, the cannot be broken part suggests that the Bible can't, in this case, it can't be broken means you can't say that it's wrong. I'm not sure how else to say that. This is not a case where it's like the scripture can't be broken in the sense that a prophecy that's given must come true, because otherwise this prophetic aspect of the scripture would be broken. It seems like it's the truth value can't be broken. You can't make scripture false. So anyway, I thought I'd pause there. Perhaps you have something to add on that point.
Yeah, sure. So two points. I mean, so one is, you know, in verse 34, he says, is it not written in your law, which is an inspecific reference. So it seems like Jesus's point is broader than just that psalm, or like, you know, just the, you know, that psalm as a prophecy. It doesn't look like a prophecy. But even if, for the sake of discussion, you wanted to say, well, the word of God means a prophecy, the statement the scriptures cannot be broken is a much more general statement. But I thought, actually, we can switch back, but I wanted to share the argument and how this fits into his overall approach. So here, let me just read one bit. Hang on, let me see if I can find the right part. 23:20. Okay, yeah, this is it. Okay, so I'm just going to read this one paragraph. The problem with referring to scripture as the word of God, of course, is that it is that conventionally it is wholly out of keeping with how the scripture itself uses the term. Okay, so his claim is that scriptural usage doesn't say that scripture is the word of God, or at least not conventionally. Scripture uses the word of God or word of the Lord in two ways, as referring to a prophecy, i.e. the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite saying, blah, 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 and that he's got footnote 20, or as a reference to the apostles' teaching, i.e. the gospel. The phrase word of God never appears to reference scripture itself. Right. As James Barr notes, the conceit of referring to belonging too much to the world of systematic theology and dogmatics has little contact with the actual biblical scholarship. Okay, so now let's look at these footnotes, because these are important. So there's going to be 20 and 21. So 20 is supposed to give us evidence that the word of God equals the prophecies. And by the way, look, many times, don't get it twisted, sometimes, yeah, the prophecies are called the word of God, and then the apostolic teaching, i.e. the gospel. And before I go down to the footnote, I think this is important, that he's defining the apostles' preaching as the gospel. Well, what in the New Testament isn't the apostles' preaching? So you and I might think of the gospel as the essentials of the Christian faith, you know, the things that you know are kind of that mere Christianity concept, or basically the focused on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and you know what you'd find in places like 1 Corinthians 15. But that's not the way he's using the term gospel. He seems to be referring to the apostles' preaching in general. He probably needs to do that because the references to the word of God in the New Testament are broad. They're going to cover everything that Jesus says and everything that the apostles say and write in scripture and stuff like that. But okay, so now let's go down to the footnote. And what I wanted to point out is exactly what you just did. So there's a long list of scripture, and it's really interesting to go through all of them. But I'll just say, let's look at the list. What you got right here in the stack is the passage that you just cited, where it sure seems like the best explanation is that Christ is equating the scriptures with the Word of God. And yet he's listing it as evidence that it is only referring to a prophecy within the scriptures. So that's this idea is tough to accept. Now, it's fun to go through all the, you know, we don't have time to go through every single reference. I have no doubt that a lot of them are prophecies, but there it is. And in let's look at some of these other New Testament references. Okay, Hebrews 11:12. Raise your hand if you know what Hebrews 11:12 says, right? The word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than every two-edged sword. Okay. Does anyone think that's just limited to only some prophecies? You know, these things to me, these are massive stretches. Or, you know, the word of God has not failed from Romans 9:6. I mean, I guess maybe someone could say, but anyways, there's plenty of other references where, frankly, what you're going to have is a bunch of references where it just talks about the word of God, and it's not clear. Is it talking about a prophecy? Is it talking about the Bible? It could be either in that context. That's not the point. But the fact is that there are a few counterexamples where it really looks like the word of God is applying to scripture itself. Puts a question on all the questionable cases. And so then his list kind of starts to boil way down. Okay, Poirier, which references are you sure are just about prophecy? And that's going to shrink the list, whittle the list way, 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 way down. So anyways, I'll leave it at that for now. Again, I'd say on the second piece where it's the apostolic preaching, when you look at these passages, it's just, they're so broad. It basically covers everything in the New Testament. And that's what he seems to be saying. So if that's the case, then, you know, we're back to the same thing. I mean, is his position the whole New Testament is the Word of God, but not the parts of the Old Testament or something like that? That would just be weird. So I'm afraid that I just totally disagree with his approach here.
To pile on to what you're saying, in the list that he has, he does have, oddly, he has Mark 7:13 as a compare, Mark 7:13 in this footnote 21, or sorry, footnote 20.
Okay.
But that one is actually quite relevant and contradicts his claim that there's no examples that refer to not only just the John one, but also this one. This one is fairly explicit that it's talking about scripture. It says, and he said unto them, full well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition. For Moses said, honor thy father and thy mother, and whoso curses father or mother, let him die the death. But you say, if a man shall say to his father or mother, it is korban, that is to say, a gift. By whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. And you suffer him no more to do anything for his father or his mother, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which you have delivered, and many such like things do you. And here, I just suggest that the honor thy father and thy mother, or whoever curses father or mother, let him die the death, those are plainly from scripture. They're specifically from the Pentateuch. And that, although Jesus isn't explicitly calling the Pentateuch scripture here, he does call it scripture elsewhere. So the idea that Mark, and Poirier would view, I would assume, Mark as one of the earliest of the Gospels, presumably not pushing it all the way into the second century. And like John, he tends to, if I'm not mistaken, he pushes it into the early second century. But Mark, he wouldn't, I would assume, he would take a Markan priority view and keep it in the first century. And here it is. It's not even a second, you know, one of the later tier ideas. It's an early tier idea on that way of looking at things. But regardless, in fact, it is what Jesus says here, that they're making the word of God of none effect. And he's using that to refer to the fifth commandment, as well as an additional command, part of the whether it's part of the civil law or just a general curse against people who curse their fathers and mothers, which regardless of which it is, how you categorize it, whether it's moral law or civil law. But anyway, he's quoting from the Torah and not just some prophecy. And this isn't prophecy. Like, this is explicitly a commandment, and Jesus calls it a commandment. So it's not the prophetic core, although Moses is clearly designated as a prophet, but it's not the prophetic core. Yeah, I just ultimately, I think his claim that it's just not nowhere used this way is way too extreme. And then on top of that, if you, like, this is just based on the exact phrase, word of God. If you put in the word of the Lord, you find that there's prophetic book after prophetic book, which introduces itself with the formula, the word of the Lord that came to the prophet so-and-so. And that formula is used over and over again for these books of scripture at the beginning of the book, either in the first line or in the first few lines. And I think Revelation has something similar. It may not use exactly the word of the Lord, but it has a similar formula at the beginning. So the idea, yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, right, at the end, the book of this prophecy, yeah.
Yeah, and you know, so I'm not denying that Revelation is a book of prophecy. Of course it's a book of prophecy, but the idea that it is the word of God is also clear, and the association between scripture and the word of God is pretty strong. The one point I would give Poirier that people might not think about is just how often the word of God is used of things that are not yet inscripturated. For example, the preached gospel is referred to as being preaching the word of God. Now, of course, if we look at how Paul preached the word of God, it was heavily dependent on Old Testament scripture in his preaching. So he would preach from the Old Testament scriptures, the word of God, to people. And he would add to that the gospel claims, whether or not they're inscripturated by Luke or another gospel author, it's less clear, but they certainly could have been. But whether or not they were is kind of beside the point. The point is just, it is interesting to see how many times this expression, word of God, is not used specifically of scripture. Now, there's a couple in there that he included where it's like the name of Jesus is the word of God in Revelation. I forget which passage. I think it was like Revelation 20-ish or 19:13. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the word of God. Well, of course, we're not saying that the person whose vesture's dipped in blood there is necessarily scripture, at least not within the illustration there. That's the man, the person with eyes as a flame of fire and many crowns on his head, and he had a name written which no one knew but himself. So that's the man on the white horse. So, yeah. Anyway, my point in this is not to say that we could reduce the expression word of God to only ever mean scripture, but just to take the opposite extreme and say it never means scripture, that's just not reasonable. But continuing on with the inspiration passages, Acts 1:16, I don't think he addressed this at all. I tried to identify, I used his scripture index, which is very helpful. I recommend that to any author. But here in Acts 1, it says, in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together were about 120, men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost, by the mouth of David, spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus, for he was numbered with us and obtained part of this ministry. So here there's this statement that the scripture has to be fulfilled, and that this is the Holy Ghost speaking by the mouth of David. And there he refers to his bishopric, Let Another Take, which is, I'm trying to remember what's the original reference in scripture. I don't I don't have it at my fingertips. Psalm 69, I think. 69 says, let their habitation be desolate and let none dwell in their tents. I'm not sure if that's what Peter has in mind there, but that may be. That is a Psalm of David. But again, it is a Psalm of David, and it does have prophetic elements to it, but it's not in that category of the prophets that the Jews had as a separate category of scripture. My ultimate point in mentioning this is that this is another example of scripture being associated with that which is spoken by the Holy Ghost through the instrumentality of his servants.
So I just looked it up. It looks like it's a combination of two quotes. So Psalm 41:9, even my close friend, someone I trusted, the one who shared the bread has turned against me. And then Psalm 109:8, may his days be few, may another take his place of leadership. Just to have those specific references. I agree with you. Now, then, you know, I suspect he would probably say, well, that's a prophecy, and then say he would just grant it, but say, well, that's prophecy is God's word within the Bible, but not all of the Bible has this feature where it's the Holy Ghost speaking by the mouth of David. So, you know, I guess, go ahead.
No, I think you're right. My reason for mentioning it, though, is that the fact that this is how Scripture is viewed, even if he's going to try to assert that not all Scripture is viewed this way, but the fact that Scripture is viewed this way is more evidence for the inspirationist understanding of 2 Timothy 3:16 as a real meaningful interpretation and not just something that was invented afterwards. He mentions another one that he puts in that footnote, that very lengthy footnote that you pointed out earlier, is Isaiah 55:11. And here again, it says, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It will not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. And then what follows is a prophecy. The point of mentioning this is not to suggest that this statement about God's word, that the primary significance is that this is a description of all scripture, but the idea that this scripture from Isaiah, which announces itself as the word of the Lord, is in fact God's word, and that it's coming forth out of his mouth. This was really one of the reasons I wanted to point this out. This idea of scripture as something that's proceeding out of God's mouth, like breath comes out of our mouths, this idea is here in Isaiah long before Paul wrote Timothy's, the second epistle to Timothy, and provides a background understanding that Paul's drawing from in writing to Timothy and to Timotheus. So let's see. If you don't have additional comments on that, the other thing I wanted to point out was Hebrews. So Hebrews 1:1-2, 2:1-4, and 3:1, beginnings of the first three chapters of Hebrews. So in Hebrews, which begins in an unusual way for an epistle, it just begins, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. So the point is that there's an important sense in which the author of Hebrews is talking about God's self-revelation, which previously came through prophets, but now has come through his Son. But even when it was through the prophets, it was God speaking. It's like a polymer and poly, I forget exactly the way it's expressed there, but it's like in many ways, in many times, In many ways, at many times in the past, God spoke like this to our fathers, or the fathers. So this is God speaking. Then we go to chapter 2. We should give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest any time we should let them slip. Because if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. So the idea of this is there's this New Testament revelation, you should be more concerned about it than you were about the Torah. The Torah is what's the one that announced every transgression and disobedience and gave an appropriate punishment for those things. The just recompense of reward is just the suitable punishment for the various offenses. So if that was important, and it was, and in fact, there was even a warning in Deuteronomy about not adding or subtracting, if I recall correctly, if that's so important, this is even more important. And again, you see this, it began to be spoken by the Lord. It's been confirmed to us by those that heard him. And the author of Hebrews seems to be kind of distancing himself even from those that heard him. Yeah, the author seems to be kind of almost being a kind of second generation witness here. And then, of course, chapter 3, there's an interesting description of Christ here as the apostle of our profession, Christ Jesus. So he's the apostle in the sense that he's sent from God. And he provides this model for the apostles as well. So in the sense that the apostles and other people with God's revelation are proclaiming this message. Some of this, I think Poirier is okay with, in the sense that he has this idea of the gospel is life-giving. But the point is that there's a task that's being given them, not just to... there's a task that's been given to them to confirm that which was heard. And this confirmation, as we know, comes to us through Scripture. It's not necessarily explicit here that it's through Scripture, but that's the message that the author of Hebrews is carrying across. And it's also, interestingly, that when you go to 2 Peter, that's his reason for putting that, what he had put there into writing, is so that it will be remembered. And that's because writing things down is a lot more liable to be remembered than just telling somebody orally something. Let's see. I saw you muted yourself, maybe some background noise or something. But if you have other comments, I'll continue on.
I could say, but yeah, for the sake of time, go ahead, because I think we got a long haul.
All right. Some of them go more quickly than that slide. That was one of the longer slides. So what about this, the bigger question in some ways about God's breath? So the etymology of theopneustos is God and breath or spirit or something like this. But this, those are the two Greek words that make up this bigger Greek word. But what is this discussion of God's breath in Scripture? Well, in favor of Poirier's view, there are places where God's breath is described as life-giving. If you remember when Adam was created, he was formed from the dust of the earth, and God breathed life into Adam. And similarly, a similar kind of description is mentioned at Job 33:4, and the withdrawal of the breath of life is described at Job 34:14. So there are this vivification understanding of God's breath isn't completely arbitrary with respect to what the Scripture has to say. And so we can't just say it's totally foreign to Scripture, but it's certainly not the only description. And in fact, we also see other uses for God's breath, such as destruction in Job 4:9, Isaiah 11:4, Isaiah 33:11. and creation in Psalm 33:6. We'll come back to that in a second, as well as rescue in 2 Samuel 22 and natural phenomenon or phenomena in Job 37. But coming back to Psalm 33:6, in the Septuagint, it's 32:6. Maybe I should actually share that verse. Let's see how I do this. Add this back. Yep. So it says, by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. So what I want to emphasize here is, you'll notice that there's the breath of his mouth mentioned here, and that is in parallel with this expression, word of the Lord. So this idea that the word of the Lord is the breath of his mouth is pretty clearly conveyed by Psalm 33:6. Now, I can appreciate that this, when we say that by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, we're talking about Genesis 1, where God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. We're not saying Genesis 1 created the world, but the link between the word of the Lord and the breath of his mouth is here in Psalm 33:6. So the idea that that scripture being an inspiration or being an inspired document flows naturally from this understanding of an identification between the word of the Lord and the breath of his mouth, if you understand further that scripture is the word of the Lord. It just happens that in this psalm, there's also a previous mention at verse 4, the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. So again, in this context, the word of the Lord and his works are kind of identified, maybe referring to the works of creation, but ultimately, the word of the Lord is used in a variety of ways in the Psalms. This isn't the only way. I kind of leave it there for a moment. I don't know. Other thoughts before I continue?
Sure. No, go ahead.
All right. So there's multiple metaphors that are associated with God's breath. That's the main point of that one. So here we come to, in the layout of the book that we're considering, part of the way that Poirier comes at this is after this questioning the idea that all scripture is inspired, he turns to a section that he refers to as the pre-origin uses of Theopneustos. And these are quotations from his email to us. I'll just read what he has to say. I'm not endorsing it, just reading what he has to say. My case for the meaning of Theopneustos is found in my discussion of the Sibylline oracles, the Testament of Abraham, Vettius and Valens, Pseudo-Plutarch, Pseudo-Phocylides, Numenius, the Corpus Hermeticum, and an inscription at the Great Sphinx, and an inscription at the Nymphaeum at Laodicea on the Lycus. So I'm not sure if there's a different Laodicea than the one on the Lycus, but just in case there is, that's the one. And then he says, I was also taken aback when your examination of the passage in the Testament of Abraham failed to consult my actual argument. In my book, I explained that the ointments were life-giving in the sense that they preserved Abraham's body perfectly for the 3 days mentioned in the text. I gave a multitude of examples of Jewish texts presupposing that upon death the human body doesn't decay for the first 3 days, so the soul may return to it. The Testament of Abraham was clearly alluding to that tradition, and it used the word theopneustos to describe the preservative qualities of the ointments. So I admit my memory of our previous episode is not great, and I'm not going to try to make a characterization of our previous episode. But I don't think our beef was so much with this part of his book.
So, okay. Yeah, I'm just looking at our past slides. We covered Tertullian, a couple quotes from Clement of Alexandria, Hippolytus, and the Corpus Hermeticum 1.30. I don't think we commented on this at all. I'm at a bit of a loss. I mean, If his point is we didn't address it, then I think that's probably fair.
And it may be his point. And I may have commented on the hit that was in the TLG for the Testament of Abraham, maybe. Okay. But I don't remember for sure. But ultimately, you know, my point is not to like criticize Poirier on this point as much as it is to question the relevance of some of these materials. The reason I question their relevance is I think it's a fair point for him to say, well, look at how they're used in these other documents and inscriptions, this other word usage of this word, especially since it's not often used in scripture. In fact, I think it's just used the one time in scripture. So given that it's not often used in scripture, let's look at other uses of this term and see what people would have understood it to mean. But I think the problem with this is that I think he's trying to swing from one end of the pendulum to the other end. That one end of the pendulum is the only thing that theopneustos ever means in any context is inspired. And the other end of the extreme is it never, until some later point, it never means inspired. And like many words, there can be a semantic range. And the meaning in the context of, like in the case of Abraham's body, there was an ointment that's described as theopneustos, if I recall correctly from his arguments. And I think he says that here in this quotation. So just taking that as a given, that that's the case. Well, I can appreciate that in that context, it almost certainly doesn't mean inspired in the sense that we mean scripture is inspired. But the question isn't, an important question is whether or not Paul has in mind that portion of the semantic range reflected in the Testament of Abraham, or whether he has a different part of the semantic range in mind. In other words, is this just another use of, like, if we saw it as the breath of God instead of a single word, if we saw it as a phrase, the breath of God, we'd be much less likely to consider these points. So just, you know, if an ointment was referred to as being the breath of God, we would understand that in a vivification sense. But if we saw it in the text, our natural inclination would be to think of it in terms of the words of God, the things that are coming out of his mouth. And so I guess the linguistic pragmatics don't seem to be fully accounted for here. In fact, none of these examples that I can see from looking through his book, and I hope I didn't miss one when I was going through, but none of them seemed to have in mind a text or a document as the thing referred to as God breathed or the breath of God or some similar concept. Instead, it was in the Sibylline oracles, at least one of these, it was like the waters were viewed as theopneustos, and there was some question about what does that mean. But I'll pause here in case you have a different recollection or you want to add some other point to that.
Go ahead.
Yes. So I'll come back to another. Go ahead.
Sorry. I was trying to look up the thing about the Sphinx. But carry on. Carry on.
I forget which page it was on, but it's. And your pagination might be different because you're using the electronic version, I think. I'll just set that to the side. We can come back to the Sphinx, perhaps. It was on like a platform that was right in front of the Sphinx, and there was actually an interesting challenge there about even reading what was the text of the inscription. And that's actually another issue. In some of these cases, the legibility of the text is an issue. But from my standpoint of my comment, my pushback on this, I don't think I think we could almost grant that it has this vivification sense in all of the cases that he's mentioned of these non-scripture literature in this category. So yeah, there it is. It came back.
Yeah. So if you want it, so.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Here's the actual inscription in Greek. But let's see. It's helpful. The letters contain the letters that concern us are the lines four or a bit misrepresented by Salt's transcription. Okay, the inscription as a whole describes the Sphinx. So it's describing the Sphinx. It's lion in body, the king of the beasts. It's lord over all and its divine aspects. Line four fits the scheme describing the Sphinx as having a therapeutic face. What does therapeutic mean in this context? Carrez, well, this person flattens out the term into a bare reference to divinity, translating it as sacred visage.
Yeah.
To his credit, he recognizes it has something to do with the animation by the imparting a divine breath, but he took the Sphinx's face of the object animated rather than the one animating. And let's see. We saw the inspiration and interpretation of this cannot apply in this context, but it makes it all the more surprising that he should posit on the basis of the word that the inscription's probably written by a Christian. What? Okay, interesting. Christian Zive Koche gives a similar interpretation. He has a holy vision and vistage enlightened by divine breath, but this last interpretation seems off mark. Okay, so... So Michelle, I was trying desperately to answer your question and I got nowhere fast, but I think this shows like these are complicated and disputed. I'm sure he's going to go on and make an argument. But these are not uncontroversial.
In fact, excellent point that at least almost all of them seem to have some amount of controversy, but for our purposes, I would almost be willing to say, let's, for the sake of argument, let's just assume that all those in that section, that all his interpretations are correct, and that a quote unquote vivificationist understanding of the word does apply in those cases. But I don't think you can generalize from that that therefore it should also apply in 2 Timothy 3 for a number of reasons. But let me pull this back up. So this was that he also gets into Tertullian. And this one is one where actually we start to have more trouble with his view. And he says he registers a complaint about how we handled his reading of Tertullian. And it's that we didn't explain his exegesis or even allude to it at all. Well, I mean, I think some of this might be him wishing we had posted something, a different kind of response than we posted. But for the people who felt like they're missing out on it, this is his own summary, I think, from his letter or email to us. And he says this: when we turn to Tertullian's argument regarding the scriptural status of Enoch, we see that the role played by 2 Timothy 3:16 remains faithful to how the verse envisions scripture as a direct support for the gospel. The inclusion of a prophetic viewpoint might be called theopneustic on inspirationist grounds, namely because it's prophetically inspired, or it might be called theopneustic on vivificationist ground, namely because it presents the content of the gospel. It's at this point that Tertullian paraphrases 2 Timothy 3:16, emphasizing the scripture's usefulness for edification as a criterion for its theopneustic status. This focus on edification tips the scale in favor of a vivificationist understanding of theopneustos, as it's difficult to understand how an edifying writing is ipso facto inspired, but it's easy to understand how it might be called life-giving, particularly if the quality of being edifying is connected with the gospel in a technical way. So, yeah, go ahead. You first, I guess.
So if the Bible is helpful, if God, it can't be God breathed if it's helpful. Well, that's overstating it. Here, let me do this. Let me bring in the quote so you can so we can see it. Present. Oh, I gotta stop this first. Sorry. All right. Here we go. Okay. Like this. Go that. Whatever. Okay. So, but since Enoch gives predictions about our Lord in the same writing, it is not for us to reject anything that pertains to us. And do we not read that every scripture suitable for edification is, and then Tertullian in Latin, it splits it into two words, not one word, two words, divinitas inspirari. I think that's going to be the issue, is that he split it into two words and that he's talking about every scripture. But as you know, it was rejected by the Jews, as with the others that speak of Christ. Nor is it astonishing if they do not accept certain writings that speak of him, as they would not receive him when he spoke to them himself. To this we only add, we possess a testimony to Enoch according to Jude the apostle. Okay, well, anyways, we'll leave it at that. But I think what's interesting is in the Latin that he split it into two words, which I don't know how. I don't know how you can say it's just life-giving. Once you have divinitas, I think you've just got to have God doing something. And he seems to be referring it to scripture. So, anyways, I think this is a pretty far uphill battle. But if I understood his argument correctly, and we can switch it back to what you had, he seems to be saying, well, because it's edifying, and we're going to directly connect it with, because it's beneficial, then it must flow towards life-giving rather than divinely inspired. As if anyone thinks that having God's word isn't beneficial. anyways, I give. I'll stop. I'll stop there. But I can't agree with what he's saying.
Yeah. I have a lot of issues with what he's saying. It's hard for me to understand the argument that I think it's because he's taking edifying in a way that's so general that he's suggesting that it wouldn't make any sense to use edification as a test for scripture. But then he turns around and says that edification could be life-giving and connected with the gospel. It seems, in other words, it seems as though he's kind of proposing a more complex theory as a better theory than a less complex, a simpler theory. And I don't follow his logic. Maybe if he were here to explain himself, I haven't been closely watching the comments. I assume he hasn't jumped into the comments and said he wants to join. If he does, of course I'd offer him to join, but. Let's see. Okay.
Speaking of comments, can I touch on one real quick? So I think this one is important to set back on. So Discerner asks, you've got to describe exactly what inspiration means and exactly how you determine what is inspired. Okay, so I'll take a very quick step. So I hold to verbal plenary inspiration. I suspect Turton Fan does as well, although I don't speak for him. So that means that the Bible is the word of God, and that's every part of it, every aspect is the word of God. Now, God spoke through human authors and is a miraculous process, but the end result is both God's words and also the human author's words. And how that is, we don't really know, but it's like when the prophet spoke of old when they were filled with the Holy Spirit. So it's something like that. But it's not like in any case, it's like those passages said, the Holy Spirit spoke by the mouth of David, or that sort of thing. But that covers all of the Bible, every aspect. Now, because the scripture cannot be broken, because thy word is truth, as in John 17, then from there we can infer that the Bible is inerrant and infallible. It's just not going to make a mistake. Why? Because God is the truth, and God knows everything. And that's why we know that the Bible is going to be complete and inspired. Now, how do you determine what's inspired? That's a different, tougher question, because that gets into the whole sola scriptura aspect. Now, there's a vast body of evidence as to why we believe the Bible is inspired, but you've got like different parts coming together from over, you know, thousands of years from multiple authors, and it integrates into this one beautiful story. You've got fulfillment of prophecy. You've got the moral authority. God commands what he commands. All he does is says, you know, I'm the Lord your God. And then he commands perfect obedience from the heart, and it's morally excellent. And, you know, so we have all these different reasons to believe the Bible, and not the least of which is the witness of the Holy Spirit within us. So there's a vast body of reason. Now, and in terms of how do you determine what's inspired? So let's say, for example, how do I determine what the popes are saying is not inspired or something like that? Well, it's because they contradict scripture. They contradict themselves. They make mistakes. How do I know what Joseph Smith, you know, like we could go on and on. Only scripture gives us a reliable record of what Christ and his apostles taught. Nothing else does. What else do you have telling you what Christ and the apostles said and taught other than the Bible? Right. So that's all we've got. So I think hopefully that gives a little bit of a background in terms of what I mean by inspiration and how it's determined. Now, in terms of Poirier's view, he's throwing out the God-breathed or Word of God aspect kind of in favor of this life-giving aspect of portions of the Bible. Hopefully that makes the contrast clear. I don't know if you want to comment on that bit or move on. Either way, whatever you want to do.
Yeah, I mean, I would say inspiration is described not only here in 2 Timothy 3, but also, as we mentioned earlier in the episode, in 2 Peter 2, which I think it's 2 Peter 2, but 1 Peter 2, which mentions that prophecy didn't have its origin in man's will, but the Holy Spirit moved those authors of scripture to write what they wrote. How exactly he did it, we're not told. And also, we are told in Hebrews that it was in various times and in various ways. So there, you know, the Ten Commandments were written by the hand of God directly in stone, and Moses wrote down what was on those tablets. But sometimes the message is just given by an angel directly to the prophet, and the prophet repeats what the angel said. Look at the book of Revelation, for example. Other times, it doesn't seem to be that method at all. Like Paul's epistles, like his epistle to Timothy isn't written in that style at all. It's not like Paul is saying, an angel told me to tell you this message in these words. So instead it's written, you know, in a different way in those cases. And so, yeah, as far as that comment goes, I thought I'd briefly come back to the Enoch point just to kind of to draw an underline Please. Underneath it. So in Tertullian's argument in the section that he's quoting or that he's referring to, the issue that's being presented is Tertullian knows about some teachings from this book of Enoch, for what we call today First Enoch, and we don't accept it as scripture. But he calls it the scripture of Enoch, and it talks about angels. And then he says, some people don't accept this as scripture because it's not included in the Jewish canon, which is an interesting, just for our friends who are interested in canon questions, it's an interesting fact that people, Christians at that time, were interested in the question of whether or not it was in the Jewish canon. And then he kind of speculates, well, maybe the reason they don't accept it is because they're incredulous that it would have survived the Great Flood. Because how would it? And then his answer is, well, but just remember, Noah is not that much of a distant descendant. He's like the great-grandson of Enoch. So he could surely have remembered this prophecy and then transmitted it onward. And, you know, there's a number of reasons to question that idea. But anyway, that's his next argument. And that God could have preserved it orally or however, down through Noah and onward down into a later time. Then he says the other reason that maybe the Jewish people took it out is because it has some kind of prophecy of Jesus in it, and they removed some of these texts because they said too much about Jesus. So he has this other kind of explanation for a shorter Jewish canon as the Jews taking things out of the scriptures. But in the middle of this, he says, but since the same scripture, by the same scripture, Enoch also preached about the Lord, and nothing that pertains to us should be rejected by us. And we read that every scripture is suitable for edification is divinely inspired. So the idea is if this was written for us, to us, and therefore it must be divinely inspired because it's there for our edification. I can appreciate how he's trying to make some kind of connection to the gospel core there, but I think it's easier to just see it as saying that this has a unique kind of edification in the sense that it's prophesying about the Lord. And therefore, he thinks that it's edifying in a important way, not just generally an interesting read or something like that. So anyway, I don't know, maybe too much detail on that point. But anyway, that's all I have to say about that for now.
Okay, yeah, go ahead on.
Yes, so after this, Poirier makes a watershed moment with Origen. So before Origen, he contests the uses of the word that might be taken as being inspirationist. But when it comes to what Origen says, he acknowledges that there's at least half dozen, I think he says seven, places where Origen uses the word in a positively inspirationist sense, and then many places where he just uses it in a neutral sense, which you can't really tell unless you read the rest of Origen, whether he means it one way or another. But just he almost uses it as a label for scripture. It's inspired scripture. Here's my concern, which is, and he raises it a little bit. He's like, where did Origen get this idea from? And he kind of tries to track it into this pagan, into some kind of pagan thought or marginal Jewish thought. But I think it might be better to just refocus Origen and his connection with the rabbinic Judaism that survived the destruction of Jerusalem. It's a changed version of Judaism. It's not identical to the Pharisees, but it's related to the Pharisees. And Origen, more than most authors of his time, had a lot of interest in the thought of the Jews, and to the point of coming up with the Hexapla. Some people have tried to attribute the Septuagint itself to Origen. I think that's a mistake. But you know, he had a huge interest in getting back to what did the Hebrew say, making sure that the Greek and Hebrew aligned, and was more interested in an understanding of the Hebrew scriptures than most other writers whose works survive. Now, obviously, what I just mentioned from Tertullian, people were interested in what the Jewish canon was, and that was influential. But nevertheless, Origen is one of those few who shows significant signs of understanding something about Jewish thought. Jerome would be another one. but Origin is one of them for sure. And it seems like a better source for his understanding of inspiration is his understanding of the Bible and specifically the Old Testament. And from my reading, I think that's a huge gap in Poirier's analysis to me. So I don't know if you have additional thoughts on that point before I continue, or.
Yeah, I mean, I disagree with him on Tertullian. Actually, wait, I did look up something. Hang on. So Irenaeus. So, hang on. Let me see if I can share the screen. I got to stop. Sorry. This is Irenaeus against heresies. And this is book 2, chapter 28, paragraph 2. And just this bit. So we should leave things of the nature of God who created us, being most properly assured that the scriptures are indeed perfect. So the scriptures are indeed perfect since they were spoken by the word of God and his Holy Spirit. Right. So, and this is Irenaeus. So he's way back, long before. Now, he doesn't use the word theonostos here, but his meaning is quite clear. And yeah, it's very natural to, it's not a big step to, in other words, the what we saw in Poirier earlier is the exact opposite of this, that the Bible isn't the word of God. But we have here a foundational element from the very earliest of church fathers that totally disagrees with Poirier. And it's a foundation on which Origen is just going to say, yeah, okay, theonostos means God breathed. I'll leave it at that.
That's an interesting observation. And it is actually another kind of less explored aspect of the book is what about the doctrine of scripture's perfection as discussed without using this specific word to discuss it. So in parallel, there's the question of what does the Greek word mean, but also the question more generally that Poirier has in mind is in a general attack on inspiration. So when you have things like you can't understand, I don't think, what Irenaeus said there without understanding it as saying that scripture is perfect in the sense of free from error. So, yeah. All right. So let's see. And I would say, in addition to considering the effect that it might have had on Origen, it is important to understand that it's not just Origen who had a healthy appreciation for Jewish tradition and had a background understanding of Judaism. Paul himself, the author of 2 Timothy, regardless of what Poirier thinks about that, he himself is a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He is familiar with the understanding of scripture that was taught at that time. And if we understand his words through the lens of the fact that he had studied under Gamaliel, then we have to consider the possibility that Paul is just talking in a way that's consistent with his background Jewish beliefs and not the Sibylline oracles or an inscription that may or may not be Christian from the Sphinx or these other kind of Jewish pagan kind of interestingly questionable sources, like the Testament of Abraham, which is like kind of this diaspora Jewish source that probably wouldn't be a massively influential work for Paul, if it even existed when Paul existed. I don't think we have any reason to think it was around at that time. But coming back to what the Jewish Encyclopedia says, now I'm not endorsing everything it says, and I'm also not suggesting that all of these views track all the way back to the first century when Paul wrote. But notice the things that it says. It says whatever book has been included in the Bible canon must necessarily have been inspired or written by the Holy Spirit. There's sources cited for that. Often the words of Scripture are taken to be exclamations of the Holy Spirit intercepting the speaker, and therefore also the work of inspiration. More sources cited. According to 4 Esdras 14:38, Ezra and his co-workers reproduced from memory the lost 24 holy books, as well as the 70 apocryphal books by the power of the Holy Spirit. So this is a legend, but it's a legend in 4th Esdras, which is quite an old work and isn't part of the analysis that I saw, at least from Poirier. The prevailing opinion is that with the last of the prophets, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi, inspiration ceased. Again, sources are cited for this. Now, I'm not suggesting that Paul believed that Ezra did reproduce all of the Old Testament canon. 24 book canon is just the canon, the same canon we have in our Old Testament. It's also sometimes numbered as a 22 book canon, but it's the same canon. And then the 70 apocryphal books, I'm not sure what that's a reference to. But I'm not suggesting Paul thought that this was the case, but I am saying that this idea of inspiration is so pervasive throughout this Jewish conception that it's hard to attribute it to Origen. In fact, the same encyclopedia goes on to describe Philo, who's another first century, I believe, or early second century Jewish author. And it says, according to Philo, whose idea of inspiration was more or less influenced by the Platonic conception of the ecstatic or God-intoxicated seer, the prophet spoke and wrote in the ecstatic state. Josephus writes, the prophets have written the original and earliest accounts of things as they learned them of God himself by inspiration. This view regarding the inspiration of the Bible as a whole is expressed also in 2 Timothy 3:16. Maimonides, enumerating the various degrees of prophecy, ascribes different degrees of inspiration to the Pentateuch, the prophets, and the writers of the third class of scripture, the hagiographa. The view regarding the plenary inspiration of the Pentateuch maintained by the rabbis and the philosophers in the Middle Ages, such as Saadia and Maimonides, I hope I'm saying it right now, and others, did not prevent them from resorting to allegorical interpretation when the literal meaning seemed opposed to human reason. So I pause here to mention this. This is a citation of Philo, also Josephus, as teaching this, and also the Jewish Encyclopedia is saying that this is the same view as reflected in the Christian scriptures, which, you know, obviously the Jewish Encyclopedia doesn't accept as part of the canon.
Real quick, I looked up the Philo of Alexandria, so roughly 20 years before Christ to 50 years after Christ, so contemporary essentially to the apostles.
Excellent. So for me, the puzzle that's unresolved by Poirier, the puzzle for him is this. If you assume that the Jewish Encyclopedia, which cites lots of sources here, if you assume that it's correct, and there's this alignment, at least at a high level, there's an alignment of an understanding of inspiration between rabbinic sources and Christian sources, how do you explain this? Is it that Origen was so influential that he also corrupted all the Jewish sources and they went along with Origen's ideas of inspiration over against their own tradition? Wouldn't it be more natural that, given Origen had interest in Jewish things, that he would get his ideas from the Jews, not them get it from him? Is it just a coincidence that they in parallel, there's this development of inspiration both by Jews and by Christians? If so, YA should offer some mechanism, some external force that would provide for this. And that's hard to locate. And then if he's going to suggest that, in fact, Origen got this from Jewish people, but that was a corruption of Christian doctrine, wouldn't it be better to suggest not that it's a corruption of Christian doctrine, but just that the author of 2 Timothy was trained as a Pharisee, as he says he was, and as he identifies himself. So with all those things in mind, I think there's some really massive holes in Poirier's theory, the massive holes being things like this. While we can say that, yes, the ointment or oil of anointing from the Testament of Abraham is not inspired in the sense that the New Testament is inspired, that's not too surprising, since it's the word is being applied in a different context than in the context of Scripture. But, and in fact, almost all of these vivification meanings are given in context where it's not words. And you could kind of imagine that there could be a word context, but ultimately in the context of words, the most natural understanding is that what proceeds from the mouth of God are the words of God, and that this identification of Scripture as being God-breathed is an identification of the Scripture as being the words spoken by God. That this concept of inspiration, the inspirationist understanding of the text, is the most natural understanding. It's why Origen went that direction, because it's the natural understanding of the text, and because it's also consonant with the Old Testament ideas of revelation, of the Second Temple Jewish understandings of inspiration reflected in Philo and Josephus, and therefore Origen in this case, not that he is always perfect, but certainly not, but in this case Origen is just faithfully proclaiming the truth, which is that all of Scripture is God-breathed in a sense of inspiration. So that's kind of my conclusion. I don't think I had any more, or I did have a miscellaneous slide. Any thoughts on this before the miscellaneous?
No, I mean, I agree with you that Origen had a foundation on which he didn't just make this up.
So miscellaneous, there was a couple of weird things that I noticed. These were more for if Poirier ever comes out with a second edition. I think he should, if he's going to try to argue this in the future, those are some gaping holes he needs to fill. Also, there's some weird things like in the analysis of 2 Peter and 2 Timothy, there's a failure to consider the old Latin translations. Gryson's edition has 2 Peter, it has 2 Timothy, and I suspect that Poirier's arguments about that, about those translations, would largely be the same as his arguments against the Vulgate. Or when I say against, I mean his arguments would be essentially the same arguments as he offered with respect to the Vulgate. But at least it's something he should be covering, because the as old as Jerome's translation is, the old Latin translations are even older, and it's hard to pin down exactly how old they are, but some of them are quite early. So we shouldn't, we can't just immediately write them off as influenced by, and also we can't just immediately write them off as influenced by Origen. So they should be, or now maybe they're influenced by Tertullian, but that might be harder to prove one way or another, or vice versa, that he's influenced by them. But whichever way it is, at least those are things that should be considered if he's going to do a thorough analysis of the ancient evidence. And as I said on the slide there, I don't think it's going to move the needle for him, either of those two points, because I think that he would, they wouldn't be explicit enough like Origen was, but at least that he could see that divinely inspired as the translation is not unique to Jerome, and it's not unique to Tertullian either. So those are my thoughts. I see we have a bunch of comments. You may have been going through them. I hadn't been. Is now a good time to do that? Or do you have additional points that we didn't cover yet?
Yeah, I actually wanted to cover one more thing. So the corpus hermeticum. Okay. I won't take more than 5 minutes, but we can go through this. So let's see, entire screen. Okay, so this is the Corpus Hermeticum 1.30. I recorded the benefices of poimeteres within myself and I exulted in being filled with what I wish. For the sleep of the body became the sobriety of the soul, and the closing of the eyes, true vision. And my silence was made pregnant with the good, and the birthing of the word became the progeny of good things. This happened to me because I took from my mind that which is of Pomandries, that which is of the word of authority. And then he recites Brian Copenhaver's translation, I have arrived inspired with the divine breath of truth. Therefore, I gave praise to God, the Father, from my soul with all my might. Author's translation. Okay. So this guy basically has a vision in his sleep, it sounds like, and he calls it Theonistos. This guy, Brian Copenhaver, translated it as the divine breath of truth. Okay. And let me switch to his analysis. And so here he lists a table of translations. Some of them are in English. I'm going to just focus on the English ones just for the sake of time. I at one point went through every single one of them and translated them from the Latin or whatever. But let's just look on the English ones, whereby I became inspired by God with truth. There's some German. Whence became God inspired, I arrived at the truth. Whom being God inspired, I came unto the plain truth, whereby I became God inspired, I attended to the abode of truth, whereby being inspired by God, I arrived at the truth. So I became full of the divine breath of truth. I have come filled with truth by God's spirit. I came to men because I was divinely inspired. Being divinely inspired by truth, I came. Divinely inspired with truth, I came. I have arrived inspired with divine breath of truth. I have come divinely inspired by truth. I became God inspired and came with truth, and on and on. Now, I'm not saying that he doesn't have some complex arguments based on the fact that it is beneficial. I don't want to give short shrift to his arguments, so I'm not going to get into his arguments. He has arguments. You can read his book. You can find out what they are. But this is not at all uncontroversial. And it seems, just superficially, that he is forcing things. I mean, it seems like there's the vast swath of people just don't agree. The people, the scholars, translators, just don't agree with him on some of these cases. I would say the same with the Tertullian quote and stuff like that. Now, I'm not saying that just because there's so many translators going the other way that he doesn't have a right to make his arguments, whatever the case might be. But some of these sure look like an awful stretch. So I'll stop there.
Yeah. It's an interesting sword with two edges when you set out to establish something as being long misunderstood. Then, as a result, you now have a weight of, you know, translator after translator after translator going against you. And ultimately, on this point, he's going to have to argue that, I would think he's going to have to argue that these translators just didn't consider the vivification meaning. They looked up, it's not a familiar word to them, they looked it up in a lexicon and found only the inspirationist understanding of it, and therefore translated it according to the lexicon, but that they should have had a better understanding that it could have this vivification sense and that would be the right one here. It's not an easy hoe to row, or row to hoe. So let's see. So
okay.
In the case of, Yeah, I feel like I could spend another half an hour going through the actual merits of the argument that he has in terms of like doing a kind of a balancing test, like which is the best reading at this point? Is it better to read this as being inspired, or is it better to be to read it as being given life, or you know what's the best sense? But yeah, that. And unfortunately, as you see in those, that wasn't the only table he has there. I think that was one of the tables. He has another one in, where was it? I think there was at least one other table like that. Maybe I'm just imagining things. But I thought he had at least one other place where he gave like a whole bunch of the translations that have been offered. Maybe it was just the one place and I just kept coming back to it. And his argument is it's been long misunderstood and everybody's been getting it wrong. And the, you know, the problem is he's up against a lot of people for that point. So let's see.
I'm done with the I mean, if you want to hit the comments, we can hit the comments or whatever.
Yeah, let's do that. Servant of Christ says hello, hello to you, hello to Michelle, Cherry, KJV, hello to Algo OPC. And looking through, he says he stirred that pot. Oh, because it is in line with an upcoming debate that James White and Trent Horn may have. I don't know if Trent Horn will make that argument again. I hope he doesn't, but you know, if he does. We'll be here to correct him.
unfortunately, the last video is going to go through Trent Horn's position and Trent Horn usage. So maybe we need a. But we will focus on Poirier at on this video. So, I think it's fair to have both. But yeah, okay.
Let's see. So, I'm kind of going. I'm trying to go through. Some of them are back and forth with each other. Hi to Mason O, who says God breathed, and Asaph was called a prophet. Indeed, I agree. See, Truth Defenders says Shalom, peace to you, Truth Defenders. The Synagogue says Shalom, Saints, peace to you as well. And let's see. Discerner says, I think my definition of inspired would be quite nuanced. Sounds like a good idea. Nuance is not a bad thing to have if it's done right. So I guess thanks to everyone who's commented. I think I covered everyone in that quick roll through the comments. But yes, thanks to everyone. Any last words from you, Dan, before we close up shop here?
Well, actually, so I was going to ask you. So I know you have debates coming up. I remember we've had one episode where we went through the 2 Peter 2:1, and so you have a limited atonement debate coming up related to that. But you have more coming up, don't you?
Let's see. I have some kind of trying to think how the best way for me to summarize them. Let's see if this is the way to do it.
Do you have a King James debate coming up? I seem to remember one.
So I have coming up, you and I have at some point in the future, a debate on free will and God's knowledge of the future, or foreknowledge and free will. Right. I don't know if Donnie has approved that topic or anything like that, but we're trying to set it up. Yeah. And it should be a good discussion. Another one that's coming up on March 11th, I'll be debating Will Kinney on Bible translation, King James only. I think it will be quite similar in substance to the last one, but I've proposed some specific topics to talk about, and hopefully it will be interesting. Those will include things like names. I did an episode in between, an extraneous episode on the satyr or satyr that's mentioned in Isaiah twice in the King James, and explaining that that means wild goat and not actually satyr, and that people or satyr or satyr, whatever the right pronunciation is, and that people should just update and improve the King James Version there, not leave in a word that means half man, half goat. In March 8th, I have scheduled a debate on, is the Apostolic Church, or was the Apostolic Church, mono-episcopal? And that's a debate with Craig Truglia, and I'm looking forward to that. That's not an often debated topic, so it should be fun. Then on March 2nd, you and I have a double-header debate where you will be debating against...
Chris Morrison, I think. Yeah.
Yes, Chris Morrison, and I'll be debating Charles Jennings, same night.
And the topic is First John, and it's Lordship versus Free Grace, essentially.
Yeah. So that should be really nice and focused. And then I have coming up before that a debate with Pastor Anthony Aquino on 2 Peter 2:1. And presumably, unless his views change between now and then, the atonement. So that is my upcoming debate schedule. Do you have a rescheduled date for the open mic Arminianism discussion?
So yes and no. So it's scheduled for April, but Marlon is trying to find an earlier date. So we'll see if that works out.
Okay.
But I am currently doing this series with Lucas on method ministries. Just kind of going through Arminianism point by point. So I've been enjoying that. And like you said, I've got that debate and the debate with you coming up, and then one more that's in the works, although it'll be on Romans 9, but we'll see. So, you are extremely busy, and, you know, you made me think of, so don't take this the wrong way. The description of Esau was he was a donkey of a man, and his hand was against everybody. And it sounds like your hand is going to be against everybody here for a while.
I've left out a debate that was not on my list as well, which is on the 27th, I think it is. C.J. Cox and I will be debating William Albrecht and Elijah Yossi on the Immaculate Conception, which will be a big debate, I think, because it's four people.
Yeah.
And it's a popular topic, and, some colorful past debates will likely bring back some people who are interested in those aspects of the debate. But also, I think I hope it will be an edifying debate on an important topic as well. So that's, I think, the 27th. So between the 19th of February and following month, I think I have like four or five debates lined up during that time. That's a lot of debates per week for me. Maybe for other people it's just a straightforward thing, but not for me. So pray for me to do a good job of honoring the truth and all of those. So I would appreciate that.
Real quick, one comment to share, Kyle Dillion. So looks like he's been interacting with Poirier, and thanked us for a review because he's going to be doing his own review.
Oh, cool. I thought I'd check if I did notify Poirier that we were going live tonight. I would be surprised if he responded because I didn't notify him very far in advance this time after he had previously indicated he couldn't make it. So we delayed it once, but I didn't want to keep indefinitely delaying it. While it's still fresh in our minds, I don't know when we'll get the opportunity again. But if he feels misrepresented, the comments in YouTube are very excellent. We hardly ever delete things from there. We probably would if people start spamming it, but so far we've been able to not have to delete a lot of comments. So any other last things? A discussion on total depravity. Is that part of the same one you mentioned, the series you mentioned?
Yeah, that's on Lucas's channel on Method Ministries, and I'll be doing hopefully weekly episodes on the different points of Arminianism.
Sounds like an interesting listen. People, check it out. Don't get your ideas from Twitter alone. No sola Twitter. It's not the way to do it. So
thank you. Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you to everyone that's commented. It's been appreciated. And God be with you.
Yeah, also with you.